manufacturing or the business sector. I worked in the service industry, particularly in the banking and financing, and then later on moved into consultancy, but worked with a lot of SMEs of this country. My focus today and my points of discussion is about a viable development model and how we can look at a more nationalistic, capitalistic approach for Sri Lanka. Within that model, I would like to draw attention to a particular type of model which I have a strong affiliation and preference to, is the model which I call Sri Lanka Incorporated, which is a business model. But before I get to that, I like to pick up some of the topics that are present in today's discussions, in today's discourse amongst politicians, economic analysts, and some of the business sector itself. So some of these topics are quite mundane, and probably you would have heard about it. It comes from the fact that we are a small country. We have no finance, or we are poor. We lack skills to compete. We do not have technology, and so on and so forth, which are very defeatist mindsets that are being spoken about. I'm saying with this mindset, you can see how our exports have fared. I mean, it's nowhere to hide in terms of looking at the statistical numbers. When you look at our exports, it's a dismal $10 billion. And we are discussing this over and over again. We are analyzing, we are dissecting, we are having many discussions around this. And we are wasting a glorious amount of people's time, money, energy. I mean, for what reason? Are we serious about developing a capitalistic model? If that is the case, let's take that for discussion. Because this whole world drives or is driven on a capitalistic model, which is based on the premise of profits. And that profit element has to be created by none other than the policy framework. Now, if you break down profits, profits is nothing but revenue minus your cost structure. In a simplistic term, how do you get your revenue? Your revenue is your market share or your access to markets, your price. And what is your cost structure? Your cost structure is your input costs, right? And your time to market, your transport cost, your labor cost. Right? Once you get those two core segments organized, then only can we be serious about talking about exports. Now, this small country defeatist attitude has been there because we say we don't have economies of scale, we are poor. I mean, it's a whole lot of eyewash and rubbish. Take some of the European small countries. Take Norway, take Belgium, take Finland. These are European countries. Or for that matter, take some of the East Asian countries that developed in the 1960s. Take South Korea. Let's look at the European countries to begin with. Let's look at Belgium. Do they have raw materials? But they export the world's best chocolate. And we are happy to eat the world's best chocolate, saying that it's from Belgium. But they don't grow a plant of cocoa. Look at Belgium in the 1960s. I'll give you some stats. In the 1960s, Belgium started off with a per capita income of only $1,200. Right? $1,270. Their GDP was only $11 billion. Okay. But what is most interesting is they were very serious about manufacturing, not services. Out of that, their total exports, manufactured exports accounted for 71%. This is in the 1960s. Right? Now what is the population? 9 million people. 9 million. So is that economies of scale there? What rubbish are we talking about when we talk about economies of scale and Sri Lanka's inability to gain markets? This is the nonsense we are dealing with. This is the rhetoric that we are hearing time and time again, which is exhaustive now. It's a time to put to end to this, because we have to be serious about developing capitalism, national capitalism. I'll give you another example. Finland. In 1960, their per capita income was 1,179. Population, 4.4 million. A predominantly agrarian country, no resources, right? Lived and exported only forestry-based products, which was pulp, paper pulp, right? Was a main type of thing, and timber, right? The GDP the exports at that point of time, manufacturing exports accounted for about 55% of their total exports in 1960s. In 1980, their per capita income went to 11,200 in 20 years. And out of that, their manufactured exports went to 70% of their total exports. Right? But population, no big deal. Right? Not as large as Sri Lanka. Oil also was a factor. Oil was a factor, but mainly, actually, Finland, that was Norway actually, oil, but Finland, professor, went into from agrarian into more technology. And one of the key names that you probably all are associated with is Nokia. Nokia started off as a pulp manufacturer. Then they moved on to a technological company. Then they became the world's largest mobile producer. That's because they got their model right. They got a state-driven machinery which focused on generating profits. They supported it. They nurtured it. They gave it the impetus to capture markets. So, for me, right, looking at these examples of Belgium, Finland, right, and also South Korea. South Korea in the 1968 started off with their heavy chemical industry initiative to be self-sufficient in steel. Everyone laughed at them. They didn't have the technology, they didn't have the skills, they didn't have the capital, they didn't have the raw materials. Imagine if that happened in Sri Lanka today. We would have been the laughing stock. Our people, ourselves, would have laughed at us. Utterly ridiculous. Utterly ridiculous. Let's get serious about this. Right? Today, South Korea, POSCO Steel, is amongst the Forbes 500 list of companies with a market cap about $18 billion, employing 132 people worldwide. Today, South Korea's per capita income is $27,000. And what are we talking about? $4,000. Let's get serious. In 1960, when South Korea started, our per capita was around $145. Theirs around $155. Where are we going with this? So, this defeatist mentality about economies of scale, comparative advantage, free trade agreements, there is absolute nonsense in this whole thing. We have to put this myth to rest. Comparative advantage doctrine, which Ricardian introduced in 1817, is a false myth. It's a false doctrine. Even the US kicked it out. US didn't adopt it. But our policymakers are continuing to talk about this nonsense in every platform. Comparative advantage is non-existent in the real world. It's competitive advantage. That's how you develop a capitalistic model. It's like saying to my children, go and play your game of cricket, but don't win. I mean, you play for the sake of playing. That's comparative advantage. Playing to win is competitive advantage. So, let's get serious about it. Let's not waste our time about it. Because we have to adopt a strong development model based on the premise of profits, and that only can be done through clear strategy, clear initiatives from the government, a proper alignment, looking at access to markets, giving our entrepreneurs the ability to take on risks, supporting risks. I mean, we have to support risk taking. That's the only way you develop entrepreneurship. We don't support risk taking. In that process of risk taking, you make mistakes. But you learn from mistakes. Every goddamn good invention in this world was made of mistakes. So why can't Sri Lankans make mistakes? Why do we rebuke a Sri Lankan company who makes a mistake? We have good brands, we have good companies, we have good entrepreneurs, but we don't believe in ourselves. We have lost our sense of belief. It comes from this mindset of we are poor, we don't have scale, we don't have capital. I mean, if South Korea did that, South Korea would have never developed. So you have to get the entire framework reorganized, re-engineered. So for me, I think there are three key initiatives that you have to undertake if you are going to be very serious about developing a strong capitalistic, national capitalistic model. We have to reshape our development approach. We have to move away, debunk, put it into the dustbin, this doctrine of comparative advantage. We have to resurface competitive advantage. And we have to look at a very strong business model type of approach, which I earlier alluded to by way of a Sri Lanka incorporated model. Only with that type of approach that we can then shift on to taking risks and giving entrepreneurships the courage to capture markets. And also, as a final cog in this whole thing, we need to develop a mindset of winning. We need to instill in some shape or form through our schooling systems, through our universities, to our business forums, through our various literature that we publish about a mindset of winning. Because it's about winning the world in a competitive environment. And one last point before I go on revisiting the risk-taking ability. I mean, we have to reinforce our belief in local exporters, local entrepreneurs, give them the ability to take on risk, empower them with the access to finance, low-cost technology, but modern technology with a supplementary financial package to access that technology. That can be only done through state banks. The state has to play a key role in this development function. The state can't move away from it. Right? I mean, if you look at countries like in Europe, and particularly in East Asia, the state played an active role in creating the pathway for businesses to go out there. And we can't talk about free trade agreements because free trade agreements have worked in the reverse for us because we don't have a product lineup to export. So, we have to look at our cost advantages. We have to look at our strategic assets, national strategic assets, which gives us that cost advantage, should not be sold. I'm completely agog with the fact that there is a discussion on giving out our strategic assets, which are core to keeping our cost structures down and having access to markets. So we cannot let that happen, and there should be a a serious effort to protect us from that depletion of your balance sheet. That's a core part of our strategy. And we have to look at lead time approach, because Sri Lanka is in a strategic position, right? We have access for 5 hours from this way. We have the East Asian markets and to the Pacific area, and then 5 hours or 3.5 hours to the Middle East, 4 hours to Africa, and probably 10 hours down or 7 hours down to European markets. So from a strategic location, we are ideally suited, but to take the full benefits of this strategic location, we have to protect our balance sheet, and our balance sheet entails or has strategic revenue generating assets. We need to protect them. We need to empower our exporters and deliver a belief system where Sri Lanka can go to be serious competitive nation and gain access to world markets. Look at this particular example. In 1996, many of you all are in some shape or form a sports lover. Sri Lanka had this defeatist mentality when we went and played cricket. In 1996, that entire dimension changed because we stood up to the world's leading cricketing nation. We took them on and we defeated them because of self-belief. And from then onwards, Sri Lanka cricket has a new vision, a new perspective, a new horizon. Similarly, we can do this in our business model. So let's be serious. Let's talk about developing a strong Sri Lankan nationalistic capitalistic model to benefit Sri Lanka, not anyone else. Let's use our savings, let's use our balance sheet savings to generate this much needed technology. Let's use our national banks to gain access to smart technology. Let's move our industries into a smarter industrialization as opposed to the industrialization that prevailed in the 19th century. We can easily do that, and let's become world champions. Thank you.